Hi again, everyone. And you might have just missed Bitcoin, but we will get to Bitcoin, right?
Maybe not Bitcoin.
Thanks, Yen. And I want to announce my guests. And like I said, on the app, there's the full bio, so I won't give everything because everyone has a lot of background, because we do have a kind of a wonky panel of a lot of interesting things, so we want to maximize our time. But to my left is Anthony Sands of Credit Suisse, who is ITS head of eSales, EMEA, and he's been there since like the late 90s, right? And
since been in past the century.
Yeah, long time. We have a few centuries altogether of industry in the market, inside and out, and Carol, which I'll get to, gives us the academic flavor. And then here is Kevin Kimmel, head of EFX at Citadel Securities. And he's been at Citadel for a while, focused on EFX now, was focused on equities for a while, been at many other firms, a few different banks, exchanges, et cetera, many places. Carol Alexander is a finance professor at the University of Sussex at the business school, and she's written several books and a four-part book on market risk, which we're not going to get into too much today. We're going to focus on her new recent year. She's been looking at crypto and blockchain, so we'll touch on that. And then we have Mohamed Hajibe, of Swissquote Bank, whose title is Senior Head of Institutional Sales. He's been there for a while and also been at several other firms. So we have a nice array, well done from our organizer. And I thought we're talking about liquidity providers, how the industry has changed, what's different, and what's nice. And we'll come back to you, Carol, and the crypto. We're going to do this in segments. We have the industry, which was, you know, mostly, you know, liquidity was provided by the big banks many years ago. It has changed. So now we have, which your panel kind of touched on a little, many different providers. So what's nice is we have like Anthony from a tier one bank. We have Kevin, who's with a non-bank liquidity provider, and Mohamed, who's with a tier two bank, an aggregator. So I want to first go to each of you three, and we'll start with you, Anthony. Tell us a little bit about your slice of liquidity providing. I know you're a tier one bank, most people more familiar with that, but tell us what your focus is and you know what your area of expertise is there.
Sure, thank you. I guess really the market for liquidity for tier one banks is, the FX market as a whole has probably changed quite a bit over the last sort of few years. The market is starting to mature. I think as the last panel said, things have changed a lot. I think that the way people are executing, the way people are accessing liquidity as well, I think there's been a big shift away perhaps from sort of single dealer systems. Obviously, that was a big push from a lot of the banks. We really wanted to get their platform on clients' desktops. And we've seen a kind of big shift from that. You know, when we talk to clients now, they say to us, please don't sell me another, you know, single dealer platform. But also as well, the technology, I think, has changed a hell of a lot in not only multi-dealer platforms, but fixed connectivity as well. And so you've got so much more flexibility to be able to price certain parts and segments of a client's flow by utilizing certainly FIX. We have some clients and we may have three or four different FIX connections into that client, specifically to target each part of their business. And that really allows us to, one, be a more consistent player for them because we're able to monetize it better. But it also allows, greater, depth of liquidity for us to show. And I think as well, one of the big things that I think has happened over the last 4 or 5 years has been this move to full amount execution. I think the market is very, very slowly moving away. Well, I was in Barcelona at TradeTech recently, and some people actually said within the next 2 years, they think the style of execution by sweeping different liquidity providers, so hitting four or five of us in succession, is probably going to finish. It's probably going to, die away over the next, year or so. That is something that we're very much advocating. If you look at all the platforms now, you look at all the multi-dealers, Bloomberg and the like, they all have a full amount offering. And that really helps the liquidity provider because he sees the total order. And, then you can say to yourself, well, what is full amount? Well, that's fine, and that's a discussion that the salesperson has to have with the client. But, you know, if you're able to see at least that part of the order, which is full amount, you're able to better price that, and you're able to better monetize that as well. Mm-hmm. So I think that's one of the big shifts that we've seen, is the style of execution from our client base. But it takes us to talk to clients. I don't like to use the word educate, because often clients are far more intelligent than I am, but just to explain to them from our perspective, from our liquidity perspective. Mm-hmm. You know, if they're hitting multiple liquidity providers, we don't know what the next liquidity provider is doing. Are they dumping the risk? Right. You know, whereas, you know, if you've got a liquidity provider that is internalizing, then you're going to get a much better execution experience from that.
Mm-hmm. Great. And Kevin, you, like I said, Citadel Securities, non-bank liquidity provider, but you are partnering with banks in different ways. So do you want to speak to what you guys are doing and how you're providing liquidity?
Yeah, sure. So our strategy is very much a wholesale liquidity strategy, where we're partnering with retail Forex brokers as well as banks in many different ways. So one of the most meaningful growth areas for us in the last year has actually been forming some unique partnerships with some of the major banks on the algo side, becoming the first disclosed liquidity provider competing kind of against anonymous venues. And then on the regional bank side, we continue to kind of build deeper relationships to help some of the regional banks service their client base that they will always need to service, even though, you know, the cost of electronic trade and the cost of technology continue to grow for them. So they can use some help with scale and other things. And on the retail side, a very big growth area and focus for us in terms of creating a lot of bespoke partnerships catered to individual major retail brokers. Mm-hmm. And I would just say that, you know, one of the main things kind of to add on to what was said earlier is that one of the things that we're looking to push more in the marketplace and also have seen some good traction is on the ability for clients or partners to measure execution quality. And we feel like that's a very important thing in terms of, one, it's good for more transparency in the market, especially when you have so many liquidity providers out there, whether it be bank, non-bank. I mean, even within the non-bank sector, right, there's a huge difference in terms of the types of models that are out there. Mm-hmm. And so one of the most important things that we see is the ability for clients to measure their liquidity providers. And then also to the concept of full amount and sweeping, also see how they are impacting the market and how they are basically either widening or widening their potential spreads as well by their execution behavior as well. So we're looking to get much deeper with each client and really become a major liquidity provider by leveraging our execution quality, given our longer term holding periods. So that's kind of what we're focused on.
And Mohamed, do you want to talk?
At Swissquote Bank, we are constructing our liquidity based on aggregation of liquidity from tier one banks and non-bank LPs, like this gentleman over there. But what is very important for us is, as Anthony said, having different types of liquidity we can fit clients' needs. Can be sweepable or full amount, but this also based on what is all this happening today, all this flash crashes can happen. It's not having a deep liquidity, it's having the right liquidity at the right time. Because when such thing happened in the market, you may have the right partners to have the liquidity who can fit your clients at that moment. And most of the time, you stick with one or two players. And this is the challenge that we may face next year, I think, is to have all type of liquidity, but also be able to handle such critical events that can be catastrophic for the client perspective, but also for the bank itself.
Well, that's what I was going to ask in some of my follow-up, and Anuja kind of touched on it as well, is what's almost a little bit mind-bending is, and we write about it in the news, you know, these volatility measures, FX vol is record lows, near record lows. And then we have these flash events. We had the yen flash rally, which I guess kind of came in that witching hour after New York closes and Tokyo comes in. I think it was a holiday, but we've had a few of them. So it almost seems like, you know, what I wanted to ask you guys, and we've all chatted a little, is there's a lot of liquidity providers then why are these things happening? And you know, Kevin, you had some thoughts too on it. Well, you know, FX is always going. You know, there. You know, obviously. So I want to talk a little bit about that. It's not just the number of liquidity providers that matters. And do some of you feel like there can be too many? I mean, they spoke about some firms cutting back on all the providers. Kevin, if I can start with you, do you think, can there be too many liquidity providers? And if there's so many, why are we having these flash events? I mean, what's your thoughts on
that? Yeah, I mean, I think you have to separate it too in terms of like, okay, maybe there's too many liquidity providers, but who has natural interest and is actually going to warehouse risk versus who's just passing stuff around, right? Mm-hmm. And I think that there's been a growth in liquidity providers. And a lot of that growth, or some of that growth, has definitely been, though, people just recycling liquidity around, but not really holding it themselves. Mm-hmm. So I think what there is not as much of these days is actually people who have true interest and are actually warehousing risk. You know, historically, the banks did that and still continue to do that. But obviously, with regulations, there's some degree of less appetite at some of the banks. And that's where we see, you know, our value add is we actually have natural interests. We're building into long-term positions based on our macro views of the market. And therefore, we think that we bring another layer of natural interest to the market that can help. But I think to answer your question, there's a lot of liquidity providers out there, but it really, you have to dive down further into who's doing what. And if you're just recycling liquidity around, it's not gonna help as much, mm-hmm. especially in times of like a flash crash when there's not a lot of liquidity. And you know, the other thing that we talked about is just, I mean, FX is a 24-hour market. You know, equities, for example, trades, you know, open, closed during the day. And in FX, you're always gonna have, you know, less liquid hours, especially these tend to happen overnight. And so there's not an easy solution. And on the flip side, you know, from a regulatory perspective, you want your liquidity providers to have the proper fuses and risk management in place so that if the market goes crazy, you don't want liquidity providers just piling on and piling on and piling on more risk. But what that also means is if you have sound controls and fuses on the liquidity provider side, that means that some people are going to turn off at different points once things get tripped, which is exactly what the regulators and everybody wants at like a micro perspective, right. But then it has larger ramifications as well.
And Anthony, you had some thoughts on this about, you know, you have to focus on what markets you're providing and that you have a depth, or, you know, how do you feel like, I mean, do you feel like sometimes it is true, it's not just the number, it's the value, and, you know, what have you done at your firm to try to make sure that the liquidity is there when people need it,
sure.
Right?
Yeah. I think really it's, you know, it's about, you know, having a client base and a client pool that's large enough to kind of cover, you know, that, you know, those liquidity times. CS has been providing EFX liquidity since 1999. So, you know, we have a very mature product, but it's one that we are constantly building upon. And I think, you know, to sort of Kevin's point, it's really those liquidity providers that know how to warehouse risk, you know how to hold risk, know, you know, how to, you know, take those positions and manage it correctly. And I think that's the big difference. And I think what you're ending up with, as sort of certainly some of the past panels said, was you're kind of cutting away and you're losing certain liquidity providers. And it is going to start to center more and more around those liquidity providers that, you know, can handle that risk, you know, to a greater degree. And I think with us, you know, looking at this whole full amount move, it's really taught us that we should be risk on more, that we should be providing more liquidity to clients. You know, what is the point if, you know, showing 10 million to a client when he actually needs to execute 20 million? So what we do now is we show a much larger size. So in Eurodollar, for example, we now quote 400 million on a streaming price. There's no other bank out there on the street that does that. Our risk guys are very comfortable with the spot business, and we are looking to push our business even further to capture this larger size offering. What you saw with algos was, you know, a big push and a big move into the algo space. We have a product called AES, which is probably the first out there to, you know, to move into FX algos. And you did see a big seismic shift in that. And then about sort of 5 years ago, it seemed to peak somewhat. And what you hear now, what you see is from most of the exchanges that for sure there is still liquidity going to algos, but it's still very much within the same client base. Mm-hmm. It's the corporate space that ticks it for the best execution. It's the asset manager, you know, the perhaps larger sizes to do. But there isn't a seismic move into the algo space because of, you know, because of the volatility in the market, the flash crash, mm-hmm. and the cost to do that execution. Mm-hmm. Clients say to me, right, so I'm paying you to take the risk. Not quite sure that fits. Yeah. So, you know, there has been a move back to principal execution, mm-hmm. And principal, you know, and providers of principal liquidity. And that's where we've stepped in. Mm-hmm. We've seen that gap. Clients have come to us and said to us, we need to do larger sizes. Mm-hmm. Can you show a larger size liquidity pool? And that's what we've started to do.
Mohamed, I'm going to go to you, and then I think we're going to turn
just
to
one word about, just one word about what's happened in January, because mm-hmm. it was quite new, I think, in the FX industry. Flash crashes used to come or used to be predictable or undestable, I would say, in a political standpoint. The problem is in January, the flash crash came from the retail side. Mm. So at the end, we are facing as a provider, as a liquidity provider, an issue once you have only one, two LP able to pressing you on this critical moment. And this is where you see that even if you have multiple liquidity provider in the industry, still few market makers are in the market, be able to having a large book and taking the risk to give you a pricing.
So it's almost deceiving that there seem like so many. I think it was Anuja said, maybe a year ago, cryptos would have been all we talked about, but now it's fading, but it's definitely not going away. So Carol, you know, luckily is here. She's going to talk to us about a little bit. I guess for now we talked about it. Probably best to think of it as an alternative asset class, although it, you know, is part of the currency world. I think some people, not you all, maybe my father who just can't understand it, you know, is it, do you pay for things with it? But Carol, do you want to talk to us? You've done a lot of work and research on cryptos and blockchain and, you know, what you see the role of it is, and will it ever be, you know, part of a medium of exchange, and, you know, what your research shows you?
Okay. So it has a lot in common with Forex. It's a bit like the sort of baby brother or sister, you know. Mm-hmm. The two worlds, the two asset classes can't ignore each other. Mm. The crypto asset class is developing really rapidly. So, I mean, there's Bitcoin, but there's central bank digital currencies, there's stable coins like Libra, and Tether. And then there's all these ICOs, which are more like commodities. So the majority of them are utility-based, or like capital markets, like bonds or shares. Every year I write my lecture notes completely from scratch because everything has changed. The Bitcoin's still there, of course. It's sort of become the numeraire. You can hedge that perfectly. It's still a very small asset class. I mean, the total market cap, of course, has gone down since the last Tether bubble. But it's really relatively small. But you can't ignore it because it's emerging. Mm-hmm. There's so many advantages, you know, like the Chinese government's probably going to bring in digital cash, some form of that, because of anti-money laundering. It's transparent, it's on a blockchain, so everything's time-stamped, and there's a certain amount of... there's pseudo-anonymity, you know, there's wallets, but you can see the IP addresses and so forth. So it's much better from the point of view of money laundering, much faster from the point of view of cross-border flows. So, you know, something like Ripple, of course, is definitely here to stay. I'm not sure about Bitcoin, but there's any number of other animals in this space that where you have tremendous amount of transparency but insufficient regulation. There are a few exchanges are like the liquidity providers. There's thousands of them. Wash trading to inflate the volume and apparent importance of these exchanges can be viewed live. Spoofing can be viewed live. And we all know that you know, those algos, those bots that are driving these manipulative trades also operate in mature Forex markets, but there you don't have so much transparency. You've got a lot of regulation, and then you've lost the volatility. You've lost the volatility in equities, even in commodities. So, you know, in crypto, there you've got the vol. So you can't ignore it. It's not just a phase that's going away. Stable coins, central bank digital currencies, ICOs, that a whole emerging asset class.
And do you feel like eventually, like I was sharing, that some of the central bankers, although I guess they have the motive to say that, say, oh, it's just not, you know, it's not going to really be a medium of exchange ever, but it seems like you disagree that it does have a serious future.
Well, most countries are currently developing CBDCs, mm-hmm. central bank digital currencies. Mm-hmm. Some already exist. Some have tried and failed. The UK is very advanced in that respect, and they see it as an alternative form of reserves, which can be interest-bearing, which has many, many advantages, particularly for cross-border and transparency purposes. And then the stable coins, of course, so we have a whole new world order emerging with what's happening in global trade. I mean, and the dollar. So, you know, Libra, of course the pressure was put on the Visa and MasterCard and various others. There's still Vodafone and various others. But, you know, it is supposed to be a decentralized backing. So in order to run a node on the Libra blockchain, you pay 10 million, it's not very much. So it should be decentralized, like it's still a private blockchain. You know, moving to a public one like Bitcoin will require a different, what we call a consensus mechanism. But the Libra blockchain is definitely here to stay. It has to be, because we need the security. I mean, at the moment, Web 2.0, we've just got this hackable API that goes to an insecure database. And our bank accounts are not safe. You know, we'll be going back to paper money unless we move to blockchain-driven Web 3.0. And it exists now. You log onto a web page, it could well be a smart contract on a blockchain. You can't tell because the GUI and the visual thing is exactly the same, but it's secure. And Facebook is moving to that blockchain. They have to for security. Mm-hmm. It's just a question of how long it takes for this almost like war against traditional currencies, for Facebook coin, the Libra coin, or any other one. There's many of them. It's not just Facebook coin, which is linked to a basket of fiat and US treasuries. Mm-hmm. So it's stable. For that to become the unit of account instead of CBDCs.
I wonder how regulators, I shouldn't say this, it's my own country, but I remember when Congress was interviewing Mark Zuckerberg about Libra, I think there was a confusion about LIBOR and Libra, and I mean, it makes me a little scared about, you know, Bloomberg might have had a story about that, but it's a high hurdle for the regulators to even keep up, you know, with the technology and such, right? Mm. I mean, so do you see a way, because you said, you know, you need a certain amount of regulation, that how do we bridge that gap? How do we get there? I mean,
well, the problem of the Asian Pacific exchanges is these liquidity providers have no regulation. They can do whatever they like. So, you know, Tether is printed by the same people who own the Bitfinex exchange, and then it's used to manipulate the spot. Then you've got the derivatives. I mean, the CME, of course, they've got Bitcoin futures, and they've got options coming out in January. But these, the unregulated, more retail derivatives exchanges are also, so the price manipulation is ridiculous. Mm. And so it's still a young asset class. You have to wait for regulation to catch up. And a load of those liquidity providers just have to be banned. I mean, they have been in China, but they just moved to Hong Kong.
You know, while we're touching on regulation, I know the panel before talked about it. Obviously, FX has had a lot of changes with the global code of conduct, and with MiFID II, et cetera. Kevin, you already touched on it a little bit, but you know, I want to talk to everyone about how they feel like, what more needs to be done. Kevin, I think you mentioned, you know, clear standards we need, and about best X. And, you know, do you see like who is the regulator that's going to add this, or are they already in play, or what would you like to see done? And I'm going to touch on this with everybody to kind of make the market more safe and sound and more transparency, which you mentioned? How can that be done exactly?
I think that the global code is a first step in the right direction. Mm-hmm. I think that there still needs to be more that could be done on that side, especially around last look, mm-hmm. Which if you look at more advanced marketplaces like equities and futures doesn't even exist. But at the very least, more transparency around that. So I think the global code was a good first step, but I think that there's a lot more that can be done. What the code doesn't tackle, which I think other asset classes have definitely benefited from, is more transparency, though, mm-hmm. right? It's very difficult for like an end asset manager or corporate to even know like what is the price in the marketplace versus like in futures and equities, there's like a national best bid offer, right? Where you know you're going to get done at least that, if not inside. And so I think that there's still a lot more to go in terms of making the market much more transparent, which will help end users ultimately be able to make sure that they're getting the best execution that mm-hmm. they can.
Mm-hmm. Mohamed, do you want to add?
Yeah, completely true about what Kevin said about the code. What putting all of us here on the stage is maybe one of the major evolution that we have in the FX in the last mm-hmm. maybe 15 years is the post-trade evolution is the prime brokerage business. And so on top of, I would say, this transparency, if there is any credit check, the all the blockchain technology can be used by the big players. So what people cares is, of course, transparency, blockchain, no problem, but still credit is key mm-hmm. to be able to be used by all the players. Mm-hmm. Otherwise, it became useless.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I think electronic execution as well just lends itself to greater transparency, mm-hmm. greater straight-through processing. You know, and I think banks these days, you know, given sort of, you know, what the FX market has been through and, over the last few years, you know, they simply have to be more transparent, mm. more whiter than white. They have to follow this code. Last look's almost disappeared anyhow, mm-hmm. you know. So, you know, I just think it's a natural kind of evolution of that, that things will naturally become cleaner mm-hmm. because of the electronic execution in that sense is driving it, is driving it further.
And do you think most of, on the asset side, the investors, I know each of you have some of your own tools, are some of the larger ones are doing their own best X analysis, right? Some of the others aren't. How do you feel with that, Anthony? Are you do you think they're mostly looking to you for that, or?
I mean, clients certainly are looking to us, but I think almost they're looking for independent as well. Mm. Because independent then, you know, is exactly what it says on the tin, right? You know, then they can look right across the market and go, right, this is not necessarily judged or biased between, you know, one particular provider. So I think really the growth in probably independent, you know, analysis from that independent TCA, for example, you know, I think that is really where the market is going to be. For sure. Sorry.
I said there's something called the Blockchain Transparency Institute that have algos to detect
right.
problematic things. So maybe in time they'll be moving to the FX space.
Sure.
Yeah. And it seems like with the more technology, I'm not saying anyone in particular, but maybe that would help move out some of the smaller, like you said, Mohamed, liquidity providers who aren't really there or just kind of recycling things that, you know, BestX may help in that process.
Yeah, I mean, that recycling, you know, even that is not something that really can continue, you know.
Yeah.
We moved away from, you know, providing liquidity to certain mm-hmm. people because we want to be seen as the font, you know. We want to be mm-hmm. the source of FX liquidity. And so, you know, seeing, you know, brokers all of a sudden contacting our spot desk to show us liquidity we're showing them is never going to work. So, you know, I think the whole idea of where people and where banks are going to show their liquidity is starting to change as well. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people, clients tend to, you know, be more respectful and look after their LPs more. Mm-hmm. I think there's been a big shift in that. And that obviously just leads to trust, it leads to growth in business between, you know, between you and the client, and that can only be a good thing.
Right.
So I think, you know, electronic, you know, trading, electronic execution is a big driver towards that.
Carol, I'm going to come back to you if you have anything else to add, what we should watch out for.
Well, I was just mentioning, sorry, the Blockchain Transparency Institute is, there's a lot of data out there, and you can see the order books and everything that you can't see. Mm-hmm. And so they can develop these algorithms, but it's like a test ground, isn't it? Once they've been done on the crypto space, they could be used internally. Why not? Mm-hmm. Or in an independent oversight, as you said. Mm-hmm.
Well, we are about at the bottom of this big ticking clock. So I want to thank my panel, everyone.
Thank you.
It was great to
have
you. Thanks for everything. I'm going to